Hello, I'm Jean Béliveau with the fifth in this series of Great Hockey Classics, the Montreal Canadiens of 1956 to 1960. This was to be our record-setting years, and although some of our stars, particularly Maurice Richard, were getting up in years, we had success during the season once again. Plante and Harvey again won the Vezina and Norris trophies. I was first All-Star center for the fourth time in 5 years. We were a healthy team and went into the playoff confident we could win again. Some experts felt our 1960 team was the strongest of the five going back to 1956. We looked like it in the playoffs. We swept Chicago in 4 games and then played Toronto. We defeated the Leafs in 4 straight games. Maurice Richard scored his last career goal in the 3rd game. This video looks back over this remarkable era and documents the opening of the Hockey Hall of Fame, where the memory of so many of these wonderful teammates will be enshrined forever. I hope you enjoy reliving this exciting moment as much as we did in winning during those 5 glorious years.
The year was 1960. John Diefenbaker was Prime Minister of Canada. In the United States, John Kennedy, a popular senator from Massachusetts, was on his way to the White House, about to replace Dwight D. Eisenhower as president. Movie fans were flocking to see Ben-Hur, starring Charlton Heston, a Hollywood epic that captured 11 Academy Awards. Some of the top songs of 1960 were El Paso, Theme from a Summer Place, and The Twist. In hockey, goalie Jacques Plante began wearing his controversial new face mask despite the objections of his coach, Toe Blake. Detroit's all-star defenseman Red Kelly balked at being traded to New York and wound up in Toronto, where new coach Punch Imlach turned him into an all-star centerman. Goalie Jack McCartan, hero of the U.S. gold medal victory at Squaw Valley, made a sparkling debut with the New York Rangers. Bobby Hull, the Golden Jet, in his 3rd season with Chicago, won the NHL scoring title with 81 points, one more than Boston's Bronco Horvath. It was a year in which the Montreal Canadiens sought a record 5 consecutive Stanley Cups. After embarking on a remarkable cup-winning streak 4 years earlier, the Canadiens were being hailed as one of the greatest hockey teams ever assembled. Members of that 1960 Montreal team included Coach Toe Blake, a former star player who was making an even bigger name for himself behind the bench. Goalie Jacques Plante, the most innovative of all big league netminders. He would post 82 shutouts in his big league career and win the Vezina Trophy 7 times. Charlie Hodge, the little backup goalie, who was also a Vezina Trophy winner later in his career. Defenseman Doug Harvey, his brilliance has been the equal of any defenseman who ever played the game. He won the Norris Trophy 6 times in his career. Albert Junior Langlois, a defenseman who joined the team in 1957 and played on 3 Stanley Cup champions. Defenseman Jean-Guy Talbot, who would develop into a first-team All-Star and eventually become assistant captain of the Canadiens. Defenseman Bob Turner, he played on all 5 Cup champions during the streak, then was traded to Chicago. Defenseman Tom Johnson, talented, hard-working, and content to play in Harvey's shadow. He won the Norris Trophy in 1959. Up front, there was Henri Richard, who, according to Blake, became a better all-round player than his illustrious brother. He played on a record 11 cup-winning teams. Maurice the Rocket Richard, under pressure, he was undoubtedly the greatest scorer in NHL history. Was Montreal captain from 56 to 60 and played on 8 cup-winning teams. Boom Boom Geoffrion, whose fearsome slap shot would be emulated by rising young stars like Hull and Mihovlich. Twice he won the scoring title, he also captured the Calder and the Hart trophies. Dickie Moore, another 2-time winner of the NHL scoring crown. In 1958 he did it while playing with a broken wrist. Big Jean Béliveau, whose brilliant career would span 20 years. A player who was literally without criticism. Played on 10 Stanley Cup winners. Marcel Bonin, a tough little winger drafted from the Boston Bruins organization. left winger Donnie Marshall, who figured prominently in all five cups during the streak. Ab McDonald, who would be traded in the offseason and play on Chicago's Stanley Cup winning team in 61. Phil Goyette, a slick centerman who played behind Béliveau and Henri Richard. Billy Hickey jumped from the Regina Pats to the Habs in time to play on the final two of the five cup-winning teams. Andre Pronovo, member of the famous kid line of Pronovo, Goyette, and Provo. Claude Provo, a superb checker, would play in over 1,000 games for Montreal and be a member of 9 Stanley Cup teams. And young centerman Ralph Backstrom, who won the Calder Trophy as best rookie in 59. Like Hickey, he played on 2 cup winners in 59 and 60. Montreal's famous cup-winning streak began in April of 56. In the finals that year, the Canadiens host the defending champion Detroit Red Wings, coached by Jimmy Skinner. With rookie coach Toe Blake behind the bench, the Canadiens open the series at home. The game is tied at 4 when Boom Boom Geoffrion's shot is stopped by Glenn Hall, but Geoffrion's there to grab his own rebound. He passes to Béliveau, who scores the winning goal. Montreal takes the opener 6-4. In Game 2, Dickie Moore passes to Henri Richard, who snaps a shot past Hall for a 2-0 Montreal lead. Montreal goes on to win the game 5-1, and the Habs take a 2-0 series lead. Back in Detroit, Ted Lindsay scores on Jacques Plante to give the Wings a 2-1 lead in the game. The Wings hold on, win 3-1, and scramble back into the series. But in Game 4, Jacques Plante is magnificent and picks up his first shutout of the playoffs. Geoffrion leads a rush and passes to Olmstead. Olmstead shoots, and the rebound comes right to Béliveau. Béliveau's goal is one of 3 scored by Montreal, and the Canadiens return to the Forum holding a 3-1 lead in the series. In Game 5, the Habs are leading 2-0 in the third period when Béliveau drives to the net. Geoffrion is there for the rebound and whips the puck past Glenn Hall. The Canadiens beat the Red Wings 3-1 and take the series 4-1. Coach Blake is a Stanley Cup winner in his first season behind the Montreal bench. A year later in 1957, the Canadiens are back to defend hockey's biggest and brightest trophy. This time against the Boston Bruins. Game 1 of the finals belongs to 35-year-old Rocket Richard, who dominates the scoring with 4 goals in a 5-1 Montreal victory. The Rocket's first goal ties the game at 1. His second is set up by Doug Harvey, who was voted the NHL's outstanding defenseman that year for the 3rd straight time. It's 2-1 Montreal. The Richard brothers, born 15 years apart, click for Montreal's 4th goal against Don Simmons. The pocket rocket to the Rocket, who has his hat trick and the Habs lead 4-1. Then, with less than 3 minutes to play, the Rocket scores his 4th goal, once again set up by brother Henri. The Rocket gets a standing ovation, and the Habs lead the series 1-0. John Béliveau's goal is the only score in Game 2, and wouldn't you know it, a fan leaps up to block the camera on the play. Montreal grabs a 2-0 series lead. Back in Boston for Game 3, Moore and Béliveau set up Boom Boom Geoffrion for one of 4 Montreal goals in the game. The Canadiens win again 4-2, and now they're overwhelming favorites to make it 2 cups in a row. But Boston isn't finished yet. Fleming McKell beats Plante with Larry Regan and Toppizzini drawing assists. McKell adds another goal, an empty netter, and the Bruins win 2-0. Back at the Forum for Game 5, the Canadiens hope to wrap up the series, while the Bruins are eager to stretch it out. It's a rough game that often threatens to get out of hand. With Montreal leading 1-0, Doug Harvey passes to Geoffrion. Over to Moore, who dives at the puck and gets it past Simmons. 2-0 Montreal. The Canadiens break the game open with 3 more goals, win 5-1, and celebrate their 2nd straight Stanley Cup triumph. 1 year later, it's another Boston-Montreal confrontation in the finals. In Game 1 at the Forum, Bruins goalie Don Simmons is caught wandering. Béliveau beats him to the puck, throws it to Moore for the winning goal in a 2-1 victory. Simmons redeems himself in Game 2. He's the game's number one star as Bruins rookie Buddy Boone scores what proves to be the winning goal in a 5-2 Boston victory. In this game, Doug Harvey, hockey's best defenseman, displays his offensive skills, skating end-to-end to beat Simmons for Montreal's second goal. But the Bruins hang on to win, and the series is tied at 1. In Game 3 at Boston, a sprawling Jean Béliveau gets the puck to Harvey. Harvey makes a perfect rink-wide pass to Henri Richard. He drops it to the Rocket, and his hard shot finds the net. The Rocket scores twice, the Pocket Rocket once. It's a 3-0 shutout for Plante and the Canadiens. In Game 4, the Bruins fight back and open up a 2-0 lead. Then Don McKenney deflects a Vic Stasiuk shot past Plante for the Bruins' third goal. Boston wins 3-1, and the series is tied at 2. Game 5 at the Forum turns out to be a thriller. With the teams tied at 2 after 60 minutes of play, the man whose specialty is overtime goals comes through once again. It's number 9, the Rocket, who scores at 5:45 into overtime. Rocket's blast propels the Canadiens into a 3-2 lead in the series. Back in Boston for Game 6, and Geoffrion makes a big play, stealing the puck from Leo Boivin and scoring what proves to be the game winner. The Canadiens win the game 5-3 and the series 4-1. Once again, the Stanley Cup celebration is theirs to enjoy. In the spring of 59, it's a new-look Toronto team under rookie general manager and coach Punch Imlach, who fight their way to the finals. And the Leafs take a 2-1 lead over the Canadiens on a Billy Harris deflection of a Tim Horton slapshot. Montreal ties the score at 2 when Claude Provost sets up 21-year-old rookie Ralph Backstrom. With the game tied at 3, Marcel Bonnat deflects in a shot by Henri Richard, and Montreal takes a 4-3 lead. The Habs score another to win 5-3 and take a one-game lead in the series. In Game 2, Doug Harvey rushes up ice and sets up Claude Provost for the winning goal in a 3-1 Montreal victory. The series shifts to Maple Leaf Gardens for Game 3. Punch Imlach says he's confident his team will come back. Tim Horton assists on the first Leaf goal by passing to Frank Mahovlich. Big M's goal mouth pass is tipped in by Billy Harris. With the score tied at 2, the game goes into overtime. After 10 minutes of play, Dick Duff scores the winner against Plante. The Montreal lead in the series is cut to 1. In Game 4, Henri Richard and Geoffrion team up for a big goal. Geoffrion's hard slap shot beats Johnny Bower, and the Habs win it 3-2. The teams move back to the Forum for Game 5. It's been a big series for Marcel Bonnat, who scores his 10th of the playoffs, tops among all scorers to give Montreal a 4-1 lead. Then Geoffrion connects with his second goal of the game, and the Habs win easily 5-1. The Cinderella Leafs would go on to become a force in the 60s, but in 59, the Canadiens are still the toast of hockey with a record 4 straight Stanley Cups. 12 months later, the Canadiens find themselves in a familiar setting, locked in a Stanley Cup battle with their old rivals, the Toronto Maple Leafs. The Leafs, with wily old veterans like Bower, Vaughn, Horton, Stanley, Armstrong, Pulford, Kelly, and a great young star in Mahovlich, are confident they'll put an end to Montreal's long reign at the top.
We were always concerned about Toronto because in the last 10 years that I played with Canadian, Toronto was the team to beat. We always had a lot of trouble against them, and especially after winning 4 Stanley Cup, was kind of hard to try to win the 5th one. It was a record at the time.
In the 60 playoff, we were a little concerned. We didn't know what was going to happen because we knew their style was a grinding type of style. We knew it wasn't going to be a walk away. And some of those players, they played the body. Toronto always played the body, and this is where we had to be a little bit more effective in trying to miss some of the bumps and the other clutch and grab that they were famous for. And as it turned out, we used a little bit of speed and finesse and waited for our chances.
Despite the optimism in the Leaf camp, the Canadiens are 5-1 favorites to take Game 1 at the Forum. They breezed through their semifinal matchup with Chicago, winning four straight. Jacques Plante blanked the Hawks in two of the games, and Bobby Hull was checked to a standstill by Provo. Meanwhile, the Leafs were eliminating Detroit 4-2. Game one. The Canadiens jump into an early lead over Toronto on Béliveau's first period goal. Then Doug Harvey makes it 2-0 with this long shot that Bauer doesn't see until it's too late.
Doug was probably one of the best defensemen that I ever seen in the National Hockey League. He could control a game. I had played him previously with the Royals before I moved up to Toronto. We came up that same year together. And he could just control everything. He was great with throwing passes and catching defense caught with getting a man out through the middle.
Without a doubt, I thought that Harvey was the best defenseman. When you talk about a defenseman, I'm not talking about all-around hockey player, just the best defenseman that I played with.
Dickie Moore's goal gives Montreal a 3-0 lead, but the second period belongs to Toronto. Bond slaps one past Plante for the first Leaf goal. Horton and Kelly lead a rush into the Montreal zone, and Kelly is pulled down beside the net. Kelly, acquired in one of the best deals Toronto ever made, has been an inspiration for players like Mahovlich and Nevin. He scrambles to his feet and gets the puck to Olmstead, who scores. The Montreal margin is cut to one. Johnny Bauer is beginning to match Plante save for save. Watch him use his head during this sequence. Bauer stops Moore from close in. Then Marcel Bonas snaps up the loose puck and drills it, catching Bauer right in the face. But Bonas fails to find the net with a second chance to score. Lady Luck deserts the Leafs a few minutes later. Henri Richard's shot from a bad angle glances in off Horton's stick, and Montreal skates off with a 4-2 victory in the opener. On the replay, Horton and Bauer look at each other in frustration as the puck deflects into the net. In game two at the Forum, the Leafs come out hitting hard and forcing the play. Imlach has them all fired up, and the early pace is terrific. Bond and Stanley team up to throw some heavy checks, and the Leafs forwards, led by Regan and Duff, carry the play to the Canadiens. But Plante catches everything thrown at him. Game two is the lowest scoring game of the series, producing only three goals. Here's one by Dickie Moore, who tips it past Bauer after being set up by the Richard brothers. On the replay, it's the rocket to Moore, over to Henri Richard, and back to Moore at the corner of the net. 1-0 Canadiens.
Dickie was at the right place at the right time all the time, and a hard worker, a guy, and not only on the ice, but in the room, off the ice, traveling. He was a super guy. He was just a marvelous guy to be with. So, you know, if you enjoy a guy like him, you have to enjoy him on the ice.
Our style, I guess, seemed to suit each other. I wasn't a fast skater. I was a laboring hockey player. And so therefore, I learned to adjust to his speed because there's only one puck, and Henry had it all the time, so all I had to do was follow him around.
Bob Pulford and Ron Stewart lead a Toronto rush, but the Montreal defense refuses to give the Leaf forwards any open ice on this night. And when the Leafs do slip through, there's Mr. Plante blocking their path to the goal. Johnny Bauer is just as hot at the other end. It's a tremendous goaltending battle between these two future Hall of Famers. Finally, Béliveau scores to put Montreal in front 2-0, and now the Canadiens check tenaciously. They're determined to help Plante collect his third playoff shutout. Plante makes a big save on Frank Mahovlich, who breaks in from the blue line. And another on Tim Horton. Finally, the Leafs' Larry Regan scores the lone Toronto goal, spoiling Plante's shutout bid. Montreal wins 2-1 and leads the series 2-0. Toe Blake is doing a masterful job behind the Montreal bench.
Toe Blake was a kind of coach that you couldn't get mad at him because he was always, he never give, never say anything bad thing against anybody in the room. Anytime he had something to say, he would call a guy in his office and tell him at man to man.
He had ways of speaking to the guys and telling him exactly on the ice, let's say in a practice, little things that would really stick in the guy's mind, and the, when he got on the ice, the guy would really work for him.
The series shifts to Maple Leaf Gardens in Toronto for games 3 and 4, and the Leafs hope that home ice and fan support will help turn things around. Bauer comes up with some big saves early in game 3. Here's one on Dickie Moore. Henri Richard can't put it in. After Donnie Marshall opens the scoring, Phil Goyette's hard shot fools Bauer. Goyette, a third-string center because of greater hockey pivots like Béliveau and Henri Richard, plays the hero's role in this game with 2 Montreal goals.
Not everybody got on the ice as often as some of the bigger-name players. It was players who had to grind out and cause a little bit of confusion on the ice so that the real goal scorers that we had on the team for power plays and so on would go out there and really get the goals that we needed. And of course, those that were grinding out, sometimes they would go in there and get the odd goal here and there, which sometimes won the hockey game.
Henri Richard scores to put Montreal up by 3. Then Carl Brewer makes a brilliant solo rush, splitting the Montreal defense. Johnny Wilson follows up to score on the play. That rush by Brewer is worth watching again. It's 3-1 Montreal. Then comes one of hockey's most memorable moments. This is the play that results in Rocket Richard's final goal. The Rocket goes behind the net. The puck squirts loose in front. A backhander, vintage Richard.
I went in around the net, made a pass to, I think, to Henry or Dickie Moore. And after that, the puck hit the goalkeeper, and I pick up the puck, and I let go a backhand, and I finally got that goal.
I remember the Rocket in many occasions, but there was fire in his eyes, in the big game especially. And one thing that amazed me is, we in between the periods, if we were down, Toe Blake would pick on him a little bit to get him going. And if we saw the Rocket would just lift his head up and look at Toe, as if to say, well, you son of a gun, just watch me go now. So he lit fires in our eyes, too, I think, because the first shift he'd get on the ice, he'd really show what he was made of and how the puck should go into the net.
In the Montreal goal, Plante is again spectacular. With the Leafs pouring in, he robs Larry Regan. Finally, Bert Olmsted spots an opening and scores on a rebound. The replay will show that Red Kelly is a key man on this goal. Plante makes the save. The rebound comes right to Olmsted's stick as Harvey and Johnson have trouble clearing the zone. But home ice and rabid fan support is no help to the Leafs. The Habs win 5-2 and hold a 3-0 lead in the series. Now Montreal is just one victory away from a 5th straight Stanley Cup. Game 4 is underway, and Big Jean Béliveau is turned aside by Bauer. Not so Geoffrion. He sails into the back of Bauer's net. Bauer and the Leafs find it impossible to stop the Montreal firepower, and Béliveau is the first to find the target.
Big Jean, as we always called him, was certainly not only the leader, but he was the ambassador, if you want, of the Club de Hockey Canadien, not only on the ice, but off the ice.
And he was respected by the opposition also, and in the playoffs, he really poured it on. I enjoyed playing with him. I played against him for many years, junior and senior, but Jean was quite a hockey player.
By now, Montreal fans are wondering if they're watching the Rockets' final game. Regrettably, he'll retire from hockey before the next season gets underway. Béliveau's goal has given the Habs a big lift, and now all the pressure is on Toronto. Johnny Bauer is sharp, but he can't hold the Montreal shooters at bay forever. Now the Canadiens move in front 2-0. It's Doug Harvey scoring through a maze of players as Bauer is screened on the play. Desperately, the Leafs try to come back. Alan Stanley sends Mahovlich in, but Plante is simply unbeatable.
Jacques proved to the management, and he had a heck of a time doing it, because any time they scored a goal, they'd blame the mask, and he couldn't see the puck at his feet. So, but he was a strong individual, and as great as he is, and great as he was, he convinced him, and he said, no, I'm not playing the game unless I can wear the mask. So you've got to give him a lot of credit, and because if you look today, every goaltender is wearing a mask.
Bauer is kept busy at the other end of the ice. Dickie Moore has a chance but fails to score, and the puck is steered to the corner. Here comes Henri Richard to the Rocket. Back to the pocket. It's in the net, 3-0 Montreal.
It's a dream of a lifetime for myself. I was 6 years old when Maurice started to play with Montreal Canadiens, and I never thought I could have played with him because of the age difference. And finally in 55 I played with him, which was a great thrill.
Bauer fights off another Montreal attack, but there's little doubt now about the outcome. The Montreal Canadiens are moments away from an 8-game playoff sweep, and more important, their 5th straight Stanley Cup. But there's a final flourish to this game as Béliveau scores from Bona and Geoffrion. Montreal wins the game 4-0 and the series 4 straight. Most fans agree this is the finest hockey team ever assembled. But it'll never be the same again, not without the Rocket.
Well, it's hard to say. I think the last one was the one that I enjoyed the most because I didn't have to work too hard, and we won the cup. That's the one that I enjoyed the most.
Montreal's record of 5 straight Stanley Cups has lasted through 3 decades now, and there are some who believe it's a hockey record that will never be broken.
I hope not. I don't want it to be broken. I'm proud of it, and I'm sure all the players who are part of that team are proud of it. They say records are meant to be broken, but there's one that I hope is never broken.
The following year, the Hockey Hall of Fame opens in Toronto. And over the years, many members of this Montreal dynasty, including builders like Senator Hartland Molson and Frank J. Selke, Coach Toe Blake, and players Jacques Plante, Butch Bouchard, Tom Johnson, Doug Harvey, Bert Olmsted, Jean Béliveau, Dickie Moore, Maurice Richard, brother Henri Richard, and Bernie Boom Boom Geoffrion have been inducted into the hall. And so they should be, for in one remarkable 5-year period, they were the best on ice.